Thank you. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak here, and thanks for attending the talk. So my talk is about TSP, or actually bipartite TSP. With the word bipartite, I will wear in the section. It will be in a certain running time, certain assumption to make this more clear during the talk. Just the first mandatory slide, I suppose, to introduce TSP. Just to maybe introduce my presentation. Yes. I think there will not be too much stuff there on the corner, but I'm not really sure. Okay, so in my notation, we can define the traffic salesman problem as the problem where we have n vertices, and between each distinct vertices, we have a distance dij. And let's say this is an integer between 1 or capital W or infinity. And then, of course, we want to find the shortest round trip that visits all these vertices exactly once. And here's an example on the right-hand side, where all the connections with cost infinity, they are not an edge. So note this is, in contrast to what we saw yesterday, this is really one of the most general cases. I'm not making any assumptions on these DIJs. And here's an, I think if I did my work homework correctly, this is the. And then, of course, just want to point out the obvious here that since I think it's a very clean problem, and if I talk to somebody that doesn't know anything about algorithms or so, I always mention this problem because it's so easy to formulate and it's also clearly motivated. So today we're going to focus on the exact worst case complexity. So we're really going to make our life hard. You don't make any compromise. But then, of course, we have to sacrifice in the time, in the running time. So we get this exponential running time. So why would you want to do this? Maybe that's something I need to dwell on for a few seconds. I should spend some sentences on it, since it may not be the thing that you typically do. So my motivation for this is, well, we know the problem is NP complete. We assume P is not equal to NP. So we are not expecting a polynomial time algorithm, but then the story is not finished at all yet. It means that there is some computational boundary. There is some particular running time that we cannot beat. And I think it's a very natural question to see what this particular running time is. Yeah. Ah, okay. Further away. Okay, let's see. Yeah, so I was saying that there is this particular running time. There should be this particular running time that you cannot beat. And yeah, I think it's a natural question to see where it is. Especially, I find it interesting whether this is, if there is some very simple algorithm that we cannot beat at all, or is it like, is the story very complicated? Like we need to come up with some very fancy algorithm in the end. That's actually up. Of course, there has been much recent interest in this kind of thing. So you can think of the strong exponential time hypothesis that says whether this brute force algorithm for CNF shots is basically the best possible, or is there a significant improvement of it? And then there are these connections, for example, with, you can ask the same question also for problems that are not NP complete but are in P. Can you beat a particular polynomial running time? Yeah. So that question, of course, has been asked already for a while. So Menger already had this very easy observation that you can just go over all permutations, and this gives you an n factorial algorithm, or maybe n factorial plus one or something like that. And then he also asked already, not looking at, okay. Should I use the audience microphone, or is that even worse?
Yeah, no.
Okay. I have to hold it the whole time? No. Okay, yeah. Okay. So 30 years later, Bellman, Held, and Karp, they answered this question positively. They came up with this with this 2 to the n, roughly 2 to the n time algorithm. Yeah, let me briefly say how this works. You may have seen it already a while ago. So we pick some arbitrary starting vertex S, and then so we're going to do some dynamic programming. So we define some PT of X. Yeah, I'm using lots of the slides, I have to admit. Yeah, thank you. So we define for every vertex T that's not equal to S and every subset X, PT of X as the minimum length of an ST path that visits these vertices X in between. So you can think in terms of a picture like this. So we're talking about paths that go from S to T, and then there is this vertex set, yellow vertex set X that's visited in between. So we're looking for the minimum length of such a path. And then we can cook up some recurrence that computes these entries PT of X in terms of PT of X prime, where X prime is smaller than X. So you can compute all these table entries in a bottom-up way. You start with the easiest subproblems, which are corresponding to X being the empty set. So if X is the empty set, then we're just talking about the path that goes from S to T directly, which is just the distance from S to T. And if X is not empty, then we have to decide some penultimate vertex of this path, some predecessor of T. So we just go over all these orderings. So we take the minimum here in the recurrence over all candidates for T prime. And then for one such a choice, we compute the minimum length of a path that goes from S to T prime and then ends with T. And the cost of such a path would be, we can look that up in this table entry here, PT prime of X minus T prime. And then we still have to account for this distance from T prime to T. So that's some recurrence you can cook up to compute all these table entries. And once you computed all of these things, then actually the optimal solution can just be found as I wrote there. So you go over all candidates for this this last vertex in the vertex that you end up with before you return to your starting vertex S. And then we still have to account for this cost D of TS here. Okay, so that's an, I think, rather easy dynamic program algorithm to solve the traveling salesman problem in roughly 2 to the power n time. And then the question is, of course, can we beat this? Can we somehow get a significant better running time? By the way, please ask as many questions as you can think of. It's nice to have some interaction also. Yeah, so still, a while ago, Karp came with another algorithm that didn't really improve the running time, but he had another pretty nice observation. So he had an alternative algorithm that also runs in 2 to the n time, roughly 2 to the n, but it only uses polynomial space. So when I say polynomial space here, but here already this capital W factor comes in there. So let's for now just think of this capital W factor as maybe small, as polynomial on n. Or maybe it's even zero, or it's yeah, it's one, so the costs are one or infinity. So then basically we're solving the Hamiltonian cycle problem. And Karp came with an algorithm that solves that problem using inclusion exclusion. So I also here I don't want to dwell too much on these algorithms. but what I really want to I want to show you two things here. That this algorithm is also very, I think, very elegant. It just fits in this small white box here. So I think that's a very short algorithm. What I also want to tell you about it is that it has this certain kind of strange flavor that we are counting some objects, and then some objects are canceling each other, and then suddenly we have the solution of our problem. So there is this kind of algebraic algorithm that is kind of typical in this research line, and it has this disadvantage that if we want to extend it to the weighted version, we get this pseudo polynomial of factor W. Okay, let me just say what the algorithm is, but let me not say much more than that. So we again fix this starting vertex S, and then we have some notation, the graph induced by X is denoted with G of X, and then we look at the adjacency matrix. So it turns out that you can just compute the number of Hamiltonian cycles in your graph with this formula here. So we sum over all subsets. So there are roughly two to the n summands here. So it is a rather large summation. But then what we're doing here is we look at the adjacency matrix of this graph induced by X. We raise it to the power n, and then we look at this this entry SS. So what's going on here is we are counting walks from S to S of length n and edges. And these walks are candidate Hamiltonian cycles. Actually, they're Hamiltonian cycles if and only if the set of vertices visited by the walk is the entire set of the graph. And there is this inclusion-exclusion sieve that kind of sieves out all the wanted walks. That is not by all a complete formulation, but if you've seen inclusion-exclusion a few times, probably you can convince yourself that this works. Yeah, so now I talked about Hamiltonian. I'm enumerating. I'm enumerating all the subsets X here. Yeah. So that's why we still. That's a good point indeed. So I promised you polynomial space, and indeed the nice thing is that if you evaluate this formula in the brain dead way, in the normal, in the naive way, actually you only need to store. So you're running through all these subsets, and then so you only need to remember which subset you currently are, and your current partial sum, and that's the only polynomial space to maintain. Was there a question? Ah, okay. Yes, I think I did that sufficiently. Okay. Yeah.
Jesper. Yeah. Where's the dependence on W? In the space in the algorithm, like given the brain dead algorithm you mentioned?
Yeah, so if you want to extend this, I didn't talk about W yet. I just said, let's say the weights are one or infinity. If you want to extend this to this promise 2 to the n times W algorithm, you need to start counting walks of a certain weight. And then, there are two ways to do that. You can put instead of the JC matrix, you can store their numbers that are like 2 to the power the weight of the edge, and then you can still do this matrix multiplication. But then you have to store very large numbers. These numbers, these integers you're working with, are very large, so that's why this W comes into the space, because even storing the partial sum is already a pseudo polynomial space. Another way is to, you can also count these walks with a simple dynamic programming algorithm, and then there will also be another parameter which is indexed by the integers 1 to W.
I see. Thanks.
Yeah. The space. This I don't know, actually. Yeah, maybe I had to be a bit careful there with n. Probably, maybe there's some way, if you are very careful, you can get rid of n. I don't know from the top of my head, to be honest. Well, yeah, already storing in which subset you are requires n bits. So maybe you can do n plus w or so. Yeah. But, okay. So then, at least in my opinion, things really got exciting. So this is a result that I really like, and I was a bit, I was quite surprised by it. by Björklund in 2010. So he proved two results. So the one is this bipartite case that I'll also talk about later on. So he managed to get a faster algorithm in this bipartite case. So that is like, that was in the paper, that was like an easier algorithm. And then there was a way to extend it to the non-bipartite case as well. So here the algorithm got a bit more complicated. So I'm not trying to describe it here. I'm just want to tell you a bit what kind of things were being used there. So it has a bit of the same flavor as the algorithm for perfect matchings based on determinants by Lovas and Edmonds also, I believe, and maybe some other people. So we are computing a determinant of a certain matrix, and determinants correspond to cycle covers in a graph. And the cycle cover is already a nice candidate for a Hamiltonian cycle. But then, of course, with the determinants, there is this strange minus one to the power sign. We don't want to have that, so we work modulo two, because then minus one to the power something is always one. So determinants are counting cycle covers for us. But then what he did with some kind of inclusion-exclusion sieve, he managed to get rid of all the cycle covers that do not form a single cycle. So this was very briefly what he did. That I should spend way more time on it if I want to explain this properly to you, but that was not my purpose today. So I expect many questions on this, but I'm not going to answer them now. And then what we did in 2013 is we got another algorithm, and it covered the case where your instance is bipartite and it is not symmetric. So there we also were able to get a bit faster algorithm. I don't want to say much more about it. But then they got us back, and they improved that algorithm as well. So what I do want to say about this algorithm, this is also what I'm talking about today, is building a lot on this algorithm. So what is different about our algorithm from the other algorithms is that what we are going to do is we are going to relax the I should be a bit careful what I'm saying. So we are going to look at a certain matrix and the rank of that matrix. So that was kind of what we introduced in this 2013 paper, and that would will also be very very crucial today. And then one thing I cannot resist to point out to you, that it came also up during my intro talk here, that they, in the same also very nice 2017 paper, they come with this very strange algorithm. It actually manages to determine if a directed graph has a Hamiltonian cycle in time faster than 2 to the n, but it needs the assumption that there are only exponentially many solutions if there is a solution. So that's probably not an assumption that you saw many times in an algorithm, that this is needed, that there are not too many solutions, then we can find a solution. This is all because we are counting things, and then if there are not that many solutions, we can work modulo some a bunch of prime numbers, and then if you work modulo with the Chinese remainder theorem, things cancel out. And let's not get into it. That's a very strange algorithm, but very nice, of course. Yeah. Strange is maybe not the right word. A very surprising algorithm. Okay, so what's the new contribution here? I should say new, but this is based on a paper from 2020, so relatively new. So the new result is that the symmetric I think this, it was my bad. I just pressed the wrong button. Sorry for that. Yes. yeah. So the if you want to go to the asymmetric case, we, even if there are no weights, we have to solve this directed Hamiltonicity problem. And yeah, we still don't really know how to do that. So yeah, it will be hard to relax that condition. The bipartite case, of course, we don't want to have this in this theorem. We would like to get rid of that term. But when I wrote the paper, of course, I had to argue in introduction that this was a great paper. But also I really believe it, that the bipartite case is a very good stepping stone towards the general case. We also saw this in Bjørklund's algorithm. And as I said, I really believe it. So I'm still actively working on trying to get rid of this bipartiteness assumption. And then this omega S2 assumption, yeah, that's a bit of a strange story, I suppose. There are not that many papers that hinge on omega being 2 for getting some, breaking through some particular barrier. I managed to dig up some references where it was stated that this is conjectured, but to be honest, I'm not really sure whether people believe it's equal to 2 or not. Let's just not discuss that assumption much more. Here's a graph of the current progress of this thing. Yes? Yeah, so it depends a bit on your model, I suppose. So you can also ask this for the Heldkarp algorithm, whereas there was a 2 to the power n squared algorithm. There was no dependence in W. It's because depending on the word model, you hope that all the arithmetic with these integers happens in constant time. And that's also what's happening in this algorithm. So it's, I guess it's still important. So in the bit complexity model, there will always be this logarithm of W in there, because yeah, even adding two numbers takes you that much time. Yeah, but in the algorithm, we're not doing any fancy things with these weights. We're just adding them sometimes and then comparing them. Okay, so there was this progress on omega. Let me not dwell too much on that. So now let's get to the new stuff, relatively new stuff. So there are 3 steps, and the step zero is, I call it step zero since it's very boring. We assume that the number of vertices is even, otherwise we add some artificial vertex. And what we achieve with this is that now we can think of a optimal solution as the best combination of 2 perfect matchings of the graph. So we are looking for 2 perfect matchings A and B that minimize the sum of the distances. So the distance of a perfect matching is just the sum of the distance of all the edges of it. Okay, that was easy. So in my example, conveniently, n was really even. And here were the 2 perfect matchings that form the Hamiltonian cycle, the optimal Hamiltonian cycle. So if we are really naive, we can even try to list all the perfect matchings first, as the first step, and then go over all combinations and see of each combination if it forms a Hamiltonian cycle, and if so, what is the one with the minimum weight? That would be a very naive algorithm. But of course, that would be very slow, because the number of perfect matchings is something like n factorial. So that's not a good idea. So then in step 2, what we do is we find a family calligraphic A of that is representative for all perfect matchings. So that word representative, I will tell you a bit more about in a second. This step better also run in faster than 2 to the n running time, because that's what we promised. And this is the place where we actually need this omega is equal to 2. Yeah, that's true. The total number of vertices, yes. So this is where we need omega S2, and actually also where we rely on that the graph is bipartite. So this word representative, let me make a bit of a digression on this, because it's kind of an important term. Okay, maybe some funny story. Suppose you're invited by your friend to go for a weekend, but it's a bit of a surprise weekend, so you don't know where you're going, but then you have to pack your suitcase, and you have these, in your closet, you have these four types of clothes, and you suspect that some of these five events are going to happen. Then, there is some consistency matrix here. Some clothes work well with some of the events. So these are not all my opinion, but it's just also to make the example work, obviously. What do you need to do? Suppose that you want to minimize the number of pieces of clothes that you bring with you. Then we're just solving the set cover problem here, right? So we're looking at the incidence matrix of the set system, where we have a set for every piece of clothes, and then the elements that we need to cover are the events. And here I found the set cover of size 2 here. And in my example, this is a seemingly unrelated story, but we should think of these clothes and the events as partial solutions that we are trying to combine. So we want to find the match between two partial solutions, and where the two partial solutions match is indicated by the one in the matrix. And at this moment, we have a family of partial solutions, like what we have in the closet, but we don't want to bring all of them with us, because that incurs some running time overhead or whatever. So in that sense, it's kind of natural sometimes to solve a set cover problem in the setting when we are doing some divide and conquer algorithm. Maybe you don't want to drag all these partial solutions with you, but only this set cover, only this representative set. With this example in mind, here's a very small observation. Let's look at the set system, calligraphic F, subset of 2 to the U. And there's this incidence matrix A, as I just displayed. The rows are indexed by F and the columns are indexed by U. So here is a small observation. If we take any row basis of this matrix, it actually will give us a set cover. That's one way to get a set cover. So when I say row basis here, when I say set cover here, I just mean that all the elements that you could cover originally, you can also cover them now. So there are no elements in the universe that are not in any set. And when I say row basis, it's actually the observation rows in any field. But we are going to use, we're going to do this in F2. Actually, everything that I will talk about today happens in F2. I think that's a pretty easy observation. If you don't see the observation, we just have to make sure that we didn't throw, if you take a row basis, we just have to make sure that in the row base, there shouldn't be a column where there was actually a one originally, but in the row basis, there's not a one. But if that happens, how can it be that actually the row basis is a row basis? Because there needs to be some linear combination of things in the row where there was a one that can be written as a linear combination of rows in the row basis. So there should be a one there as well in that same column. Okay, that's not sure if that clarified things, but yeah. Okay, so that's it's an observation. So in this example, we actually get working in F2, we get this as a row basis, one example of a row basis. So it doesn't give us an necessarily optimal set cover, but it does give us one of size at most the rank of the matrix. Okay, now getting back to this slide. I wanted to prepare you a bit for this definition of representative, because it's a full box here. So it's still not exactly what I told you about. We have to tweak the story a tiny bit. So let's go over it. So we say that if we have this calligraphic A, which is a subset of calligraphic A prime, if both are families of perfect matchings, then we say that the subset calligraphic A is representative for A prime if for each perfect matching B, of Kn. So that's important. I'm focusing here on any perfect matching B. It doesn't need to be restricted to the graph we are looking at. If for any perfect matching B, the best you can do in A to combine with B, so the best perfect matching in A that forms a Hamiltonian cycle, and A prime in calibration. Does it help that I'm here? I guess not.
Say something.
Yes, I'm saying something.
Okay. All right. Well, now, okay, good. Now here. I was just worried that you had accidentally muted yourself or something.
Okay. Maybe I should. Yeah, okay. So that was this important definition of representative. So getting back to the picture here. You may think that I have some preferences with these pieces of clothes. Some I like more than others. And now the condition needs to be that for every event, I didn't lose anything by throwing away something in this. So for example, in this so this is a Dutch celebration thing. It's called Carnival. There are these two options that work with Carnival. The condition should be, so the best I can do is this a neutral phase. So for Carnival, I still want to be at least in this neutral phase, or even better, but better is not possible. So for every possible scenario, we want to be as happy as possible. So it's a bit different than set cover, I suppose. But still, you can argue that if you take, actually, I argued this on this slide, I suppose. No, I don't, sorry. Still, we can argue that if you take this row basis, and now I should say minimum weight row basis, there is always a row basis of minimum weight, that actually would still be a representative set in this more general weighted setting as well. Okay, so that is what's happening in step one. I'll say a bit more about it in a second, but first I want to give you the complete picture of the algorithm. In step two, probably you kind of already could have guessed what I'm going to do in step two. So now in step two, we just need to work with this calligraphic A and find out of all pairs, we need to find the pair that forms the Hamiltonian cycle. So that's what we need to do. And the running time ends up to be something what I wrote here. And I should actually say in this 2020 paper, this step two is where the new part happens. This step one, I think of it as a bit more boring myself. Okay, so that's the complete picture. And now unless there are questions, I want to tell you a bit more about step one, maybe make it slightly more concrete. Yeah, that's a very good question. I said it's important, but now you ask this question. Oh, sorry, yes. Yeah, so I earlier said in the definition of representatives here, I told everybody that is, can I mark this? Okay, no. I told everybody that this, I'm assuming here that every perfect matching B of Kn, I said that B can be any perfect matching, and what we also could have said is indeed that B is restricted to the instance that we are having here. That would have been more natural. And actually, it's a very good question. I said it's very important, but for this particular application, how I'm oversimplifying things a bit, it's actually not that important indeed. So, it actually is really important in when you do things So often these perfect meshings, they don't really come from the graph, but maybe they are the endpoints of certain paths. If you're dividing the tour in a different way, not in two perfect meshings, but maybe in a bunch of segments, then it becomes very important that you you're weaponed against any perfect matching. Yeah, and also I don't really know at this moment how to exploit this weaker construction, this weaker variant. Yeah.
Jesper.
Yeah.
Are we doing so in the previous definition? Like, are you working with like matchings in the complete graph or in the complete bipartite graph?
In the complete graph.
I see. Okay. Yeah. But you're only applying it now for bipartite graphs.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. So now this step one. Let me be a bit more explicit about it. So we have to define the relevant incidence matrix first. And this is what we called in this 2013 paper the matching connectivity matrix. So it is defined for every even n as the matrix that's indexed by all perfect matchings. And you put the one if the two perfect matchings form a Hamiltonian cycle, and you put a zero otherwise. That is the matching connectivity matrix. And I always like to give you some examples of these. Of these matrices. So here's H4, there are only three perfect matchings on four elements, and the two perfect matchings form a Hamiltonian cycle if and only if they are not the same perfect matching. And for H6, it's bigger, there are 15 of them. So that's the matching connectivity matrix. So we can actually again think of our problem in terms of this matrix. So in our example instance, we had these five perfect matchings of a certain weight. So we can think of the corresponding rows and columns. And basically what we need to do is we need to find in the intersection of the orange rows and columns, we need to find the one. And out of these, all of these ones, we need to find the one that has the minimum row weight plus column weight. So these are the ones. So in step one, what we now can do is we can do linear algebra in this matrix. And we can observe that these five rows, they are linearly dependent in F2. They all have an even number of ones in every column. And therefore, we can just throw away the one with the highest weight, and we will get the representative set. So that's what the story that I told you so far, is what we will do here. And now you may wonder, yeah, how do we do this quickly? Because this matching connectivity matrix actually has huge dimensions. Recall there are like n to the power n perfect matchings. But the nice thing is that this matrix has very low rank. So one thing that we showed in 2013 is that this matrix can be factorized as follows. So we have this equality 2. So again, to emphasize that we are working in F2 here. So the matrix can be factorized as, so we take all the rows in the matrix and then we take Pn and then the same transpose. And Pn is the set of perfect matchings of this very specific graph that I just drew. So think of this graph. So that graph has a family of perfect matchings, and that perfect matching family of perfect matchings we call calligraphic P. And for that calligraphic P, we will get this factorization that I wrote there. And then, yeah, so what do we find interesting of a factorization? Well, the inner dimension would be very interesting because that also gives you a bound on the rank. So how many perfect matchings are there in this graph? Well, if you think about it, this vertex one has to be matched to somebody. It's either two or three, but then one of two or three is actually still unmatched. So he has to be matched to either four or five. Then one of the four and five is unmatched. And again, we need to make a decision. So actually we need to make n over two minus one decisions here, because in the very last part here, it's already fixed what we need to do. So there are actually 2^(n/2-1) of these perfect matchings. And that also tells us that the rank of this matrix over F2 is 2^(n/2-1). So that's a very good plus sign. This is a very low rank, this matrix. So what we can actually do to find compute this representative set, we can think of this matrix H6 with all rows, say, and this family of perfect matchings. So P6 turns out to be these particular four perfect matchings. And actually, we don't want to construct the whole matrix because, again, there are n to the power n rows. But we only want to find in this matrix, we want to find a minimum row basis of the matrix induced by all the orange rows and these four blue columns. So that's actually what the algorithm for computing a representative set does. So it computes this matrix, formed the submatrix of the matching commutativity matrix induced by all rows in calligraphic A. Calligraphic A was the family of perfect matchings of which we need to compute a representative set, and the columns from Pn. So that gives you a matrix that is small enough for us. The size is the cardinality of calligraphic A times the cardinality of Pn, which is only 2 to the n over 2. So this gives us a matrix that's at least of size 2 to the, or that's of size 2 to the small O of n. 2 to the big O of n, sorry. So it's a relatively small matrix, and there we can actually do some Gaussian elimination to compute this row basis. So that's what we observed in 2013, that we can compute in this matrix the minimum row basis, and that gives us this desired representative set. But then in this new paper, if you want to do this bipartite want to get faster than 2 to the n, unfortunately, this still gets us too much overhead. So actually, the story in step one in this particular paper, it's more ugly, and I didn't want to talk about that. So I'm just telling you this nice story. Are there any questions about this part?
Yeah, Jesper, is there, any reason we couldn't come up with a more explicit row basis?
A more explicit row basis? Is that your question?
Yeah, in the sense of as opposed to using Gaussian, as opposed to doing it algorithmically, is given that the matrix is fixed.
Yeah.
Right. Couldn't we kind of magically guess it if one was smart enough? Some sort of explicit formula or something for the elements of the row basis, or.
Yeah, that is exactly what I'm already wondering for since 2013,
yeah,
to be honest.
Yeah, I see. Yeah, we do something better. These things are hard, I'm sure.
Yeah.
There's no obstruction to that, is what I'm
saying. You would think that we can exploit more structure about this particular matrix. Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
Yeah, I would, I don't know. Maybe that's true, but I cannot help you with that now, unfortunately.
Yes, that's okay.
Yeah. Well, there's this subfamily of perfect matchings. It's in the weights, some guys have weight infinity, so we don't consider them at all. Yeah. Definitely not in polynomial time. I'm every time asking myself many of these questions, can I do faster than 2 to the n? Even that I'm not sure at the moment. This is all kind of this is all these questions, they are actually also relevant for getting rid of this bipartiteness assumption. This is really the bottleneck. We want to do something better than Gaussian elimination there, but I do not know how to do it. And it's not only me. There were also some relevant other papers where people really want to get faster algorithms for finding these representative sets. And it's not, so I still have, do I have 15 minutes or 10 minutes? 15, okay, yeah. So then let's say a bit more about step two, which was the relatively new part, as I mentioned. So it's again, we have these two one family of perfect matchings, and each perfect matching has a distance or a weight. And then we want to find the combination that has the minimum weight and forms a Hamiltonian cycle. So that's here. I didn't talk about this at all. The omega is 2 here. So I talked about can we do it in 2 to the power big O of n or slower? And I kind of argued how we do it in 2 to the power big O of n, because this matrix is small enough and you do Gaussian elimination in some polynomial time. If you're interested in why we're doing where we need omega is 2, I would need to tell you way more about this, how I actually exploit bipartiteness. So I'm hiding a lot of details here. So it has to do something with PathWidth. So there is an algorithm that solves a traveling salesman problem in time 4 to the power PathWidth, assuming omega is 2. And the PathWidth of bipartite graph is n over 2. So if you concatenate that, you already get a 2 to the n time algorithm for TSP on bipartite graphs. And then there is some way to get a tiny bit better than that. But it's kind of, I shouldn't get into much more of it. It only raises more questions, I think, at this point. Yeah. But of course, I'm happy to elaborate on all of these afterwards. So now getting to step 2. In step 2, there is a step 2a and 2b. And in 2a, we are getting rid of these weights. And also this is something that I do not want to tell too much about. It's a relatively simple trick. But in step B is where the newest part came. And I think that's more interesting. So now we are going to focus right away on step 2B. Stated differently now. So what we can do is we can we now look at the problem where we're just given a family of perfect matchings, and we want to detect if there is a pair that forms a Hamiltonian cycle. So there are no weights or distances anymore. And I'm first going to try to convince you that this problem can be solved in time, the cardinality of A times 2 to the n over 2. So that's, of course, not very impressive if calligraphic A is of size polynomial on n or so, but in this regime, these representative sets, this if this calligraphic A is a representative set, is also of exponential size. So it can be very interesting if the cardinality of A is large enough, because this then can improve this quadratic time algorithm. Yes, you can do it in cardinality of A squared, yes. So this is not very very useful yet, but I'm going to improve the algorithm later on. Yeah, so I will get, so what was in this 2020 paper, I think major insight, or the biggest insight in the paper was that, so here it's like 2 to the power 0.49 n, so there was a bit of an improvement there. Yeah, indeed, if A is a representative set, we know it's of size at most 2 to the n over 2, so the quadratic time algorithm can also get this ring time. Yeah. So it builds on Freifalt's check, which I suppose many of you know. So suppose you have three matrices, say M and L and R, but you're too lazy to multiply L and R because that takes too much time. So what you can do is you can draw some random vectors, say Y and X, and then you can just multiply, pre-multiply y with m with y and post-multiply with x. And then you can also do the same with L and R. And then you can check whether this is actually the same or not. So that gives you a sanity check. If you get different outcomes of the different computations, you know for sure that m and L times R are different. But it also works the other way around. If you get the same outcome, then with good probability, you actually, if the matrices were the same, then with good probability, you will also conclude that they are the same with this check. This holds in any field, I think. If the field gets larger, it's even better. Yeah. So we are now still in this setting with this matching connectivity matrix. And we have a bunch of unweighted matchings now, since I'm talking about the unweighted variant. And again, now we just want to know if there is a one in this matrix induced by these orange elements. So is that the all zero matrix, or is it the matrix that's not the all zero matrix? Yeah, that's what we need to check. So we can just use this Vrijvels check here. So we sample X and Y, and we compute Y transpose times this induced matrix times X. And then if you get the number zero, then we conclude that there's no solution. If you get something non-zero, we know for sure that there is a solution. That's the algorithm now. But now we can actually use this factorization that I told you. So we know that H of n can be factorized in these, I told you, this matching factorization.
Yes. Just out of confusion here, is it HN calligraphic A, calligraphic B? Or so why are we doing A twice? Need to check that HN AA equals zero? Like B doesn't appear in that.
So it's I'm very sneaky with my notation. I have sometimes capital A, sometimes script A, calligraphic A. So here we have two times calligraphic A. So we look at the submatrix where all the rows and columns are restricted to everything in calligraphic A. And that is the all zero matrix if and only if there's a pair A comma B in calligraphic A that forms a Hamiltonian cycle.
Does not form. Sorry, I thought ones in the matrix were Hamiltonian cycles.
Yes. Oh, did I say it? Maybe I said it the other way around. Yeah. So it's a zero. It's the induced matrix is a zero matrix if and only if there is no pair.
Yes. So you want to, but you need to restrict to A and B, right? Like somehow, because now you're just looking at calligraphic A, and now. Where is A and B in calligraphic A?
Yeah, there is no calligraphic B. It's just one family of matchings.
Okay, fair enough.
Was there a calligraphic B earlier, actually?
No, it was A, B, one.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, okay, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. In the previous version of my talk, there was calligraphic A and calligraphic B. So I'm also need to double check. Yeah. Okay. So that's what I said. This is what we need to compute, this quantity here. But since we have this this factorization, we can actually do this. So this Y transpose times this matrix. So this this induced matrix is of size the cardinality of A times 2 to the n over 2. So this is matrix vector multiplication where the matrix is of that size, and we can do that in time linear in the size of the matrix. And we do the same on the other end side, on the other side, and then we just have to compute the inner product of two vectors. So we compute this this expression here in the naive way. And if we do that, then we get some number and we output yes if and only if that is non-zero. So that has to be equal to one there in the F2. So that will be the algorithm, which is still a bit too slow for us, but it would be a nice start. And the runtime follows. So, and this is of course what you always get in these talks. If you really get to the new exciting stuff, you only have 5 minutes left. But if everything so far was clear, I'm happy. So one thing I want to say about this thing, that there is also another factorization, which is the cut factorization. And that is written here as Cn times Cn transposed. And it's indexed by all subsets. And we put a one in this matrix if the cut splits the matching, and a zero otherwise. And splits here means that there is no edge in the matching that has exactly one endpoint in the set. So here's a matching, here's a cut that splits it, here's a cut that does not split it. So this also gives you a factorization. And this one is actually not that hard to see. So if you have two perfect matchings and they form one connect component, there's only one cut that splits it, because every vertex needs to be in the same side of the cut. If you form a single cycle, there's only one way to not split both these perfect matchings. On the other hand, if the two perfect matchings form a cycle cover with more connect components, then for each connect component, you have a choice to put it entirely in the cut or not. So you will get an even number of choices. And since we are working modulo 2, an even number is equal to 0. Might have gone a bit fast, but I'm just saying that's not that hard, that factorization. So that factorization is not that awesome in terms of rank, because there are 2 to the n roughly cuts. But what is very nice is that if you give you one matching, spoiling here the crux. If you have one matching, there are only a few cuts that split it. There are only 2 to the n over 2 roughly cuts that split it. For each matching, you have to make the decision. So there are these 2 different factorizations, and they are kind of incomparable. The left one is very narrow, but it is also dense. 2 perfect matchings, 2 random perfect matchings from a Hamiltonian cycle with probability roughly 1 over square root n. So it's a very dense matrix. And the other one has a bit larger rank, but it is very sparse. And now if I told all of this to you, so what we did here in this 2020 paper is we just apply these 2 factorizations after each other, and we got another factorization, which is also indexed by cuts, but actually by a smaller family of cuts. So we say script C of n are all the cuts that split some matching in this special family of perfect matchings Pn. It turns out that this is a rather small family of matchings, and there's still some kind of factorization. Whenever I put in a star, I'm hiding some details, by the way. So this is also not the real factorization, it's slightly more complicated. And the crux here is that it still has a maybe decent rank, not as good as the matchings factorization. But if you look at the sparsity of this matrix, on average, per row, per matching, there are only few of these non-zeros. So it actually, if you look at every row, there are fewer non-zeros than in both of the other matrices. Okay, if you believe me on that, so what is now the point that I want to get to? If you get to this previous algorithm, it's exactly the same algorithm, but now we use this different factorization, then we get a better algorithm. Since we have a matrix that is very sparse, there is some way to exploit it. There are some technical details. It's only on average, so you somehow need to deal with that. You need to actually enumerate these zeros there, which is also not trivial, but it can be done. And if you combine all of that, you get this slightly faster algorithm that I listed. I think it's time to move to the last slide. So it's not the last slide. I told you this bipartiteness assumption. I didn't tell much about it. It would take me a bit of time to explain to you. Happy to do it afterwards. Something more general that I want to say is that it's rank upper bounds. If you do some divide and conquer algorithm, maybe sometimes think about putting up this matrix that indicates whether 2 partial solutions give total solution. Maybe studying the rank of that matrix, sometimes it gives you some algorithmic improvements. And also what we did here, it's kind of an algebraic algorithm since you talk about rank as such. Still, with the Gaussian elimination, it still applies for these weighted problems. That's a nice thing. Just advertising some survey about this, also some other problems where this can be used. And then let me just finish by putting this slide here to read.